good afternoon. Are you ready for this session? Immediate tooth replacement, one of the most controversial procedures there is. Because as you know, some people out there, they absolutely think that this type of procedure is dangerous. Should you do it? Should you not? And we're going to try to solve the puzzle today. Gabor, are you ready?
So thank you so much to the audience for having me here. I was the first lecturer this morning at the N1 session, and I'm the last on stage today to conclude it. My task was to talk about immediate implants, the posterior maxilla and mandible, and give a clinical surgical approach to that. The maxillary premolars, I'm often being asked, how do I get into the field of immediate implants? How do I start? By young dentists, by people who come to my practice for so-called hospitations. And I always say, start with a premolar. That's what you might want to do. I got a big referral practice, so referring dentists keep sending the patients with fractured premolars. Sometimes the patient in the morning, when he's eating his cereal, doesn't know that he's going to have an implant in a few hours, because he doesn't know that his premolar, which might be endodontically treated, might fracture. Like this case, fractured, it's a short phone call to the GP, it's a short explanation to the patient. Then the crucial part is to remove the tooth without destroying the whole socket. That's the biggest task. And then it's a gentle extraction, which is less than a minute, patient being referred back. A replace select implant, the patient came back after 10 years for a follow-up. This was my working horse, this implant, for so many years. Then we did the next step. This is a noble replace CC, a conical connection implant. This tooth had a so-called fossa root. The endo treatment failed, I think, at the time when the pin, when the post was placed in the implant. Again, tooth removed, and the new implant in those days placed, it's like 78 years ago, the bone stays fantastically above the so-called, about the prosthetic concept of the so-called platform shift. And now what's new? N1, I had the privilege this morning to be the chair of the N1 session when we broke the news to present a brand new implant. And I think we are going into the right direction. This is the implant which is coming, the N1 implant, which is fulfilling all what you guys have postulated, what you claimed, and all that is to be underlined, and like the one implant, one time concept. This is where we go. Same indication, fractured premolar, so this is how to get into immediate implants and place the abutment right away. I try to cover in this remaining time the posterior maxilla and the lateral, and I want to go on a journey with you. This is what we used to do in the old days, sinus lifting, and we sinus lifted way too much. Iliac crest grafts. These iliac crest grafts were painful for much longer than the dental treatment. Today, I think we can perform much better than that, and we don't need that as often as we did in those days. This journey is one patient, same patient, two sides of the same patients, 11 years apart, complete change of mind, change of paradigm. She came 2004 for the upper left, and on that year, 2004, the sinus lift was performed. Standard procedure with membranes, with bone substitutes, bone harvesting from the mandible, the tuberosity, performed the sinus lift, place the implant, restore it, happy ever after, good. She came back 11 years later and said, "Doctor, I'm back. I think I need, again, my sinus lift for the next side." And I was like, "What do you mean sinus lift? Times have changed, we're in the middle of immediacy." So same treatment, completely different concept. Remove the teeth, place the immediate implants, suture, let it heal, restore, and same result, but completely different outcome for the patient. I mean, the outcome is the same, but the way to get there. One is 2-3 months, and the other one is 18 months. Costs are a fraction. Pain is a fraction. Chairside time, for us all, is a fraction. So just bear in your mind that maybe not all of the sinus lifts which we perform are necessary. I take it to the next level here. Infected sites, immediate implantation. Here, the lateral incisor was done at the same time as the posterior maxilla, but I'm focusing on the maxilla. Remove those teeth, they were mobile, they were painful. Nice, gentle extraction. Place the implants in place. Impression taking in those days, we were not doing it digital, it's back 8-9 years ago. Then the immediate loading, immediate bridge, same day, it's a composite bridge. That's the not well kept and well cleaned immediate exchange for the final restoration. Whole thing is done in 2.5 to 3 months. Very easy thing to go if you respect the laws of immediate placement. But respect anatomy. Joe, when we talked a few weeks ago about the session on the phone, he was in California and I was in Switzerland in the Nobel headquarters. He said, please highlight anatomy, that placing an implant in a posterior maxilla is not just placing an implant into the palatal socket. If you place it in the palatal socket and you don't have enough bone, you might get a resorption. The palatal bone in the maxilla is similar like the buckle in the front. It might resorb if you put too much pressure on it. So respect anatomy, and yes, upper molars are tricky and not always possible. Patients today are very critical. They consult the worst doctor in the world. The worst doctor is Dr. Google. A friend of mine has a shield, has a sign in his practice which says, for those of my patients who had the first opinion by Dr. Google, please get the treatment by Dr. Yahoo. Dr. Google is not always the best to go to, but it's good that patients now get a second opinion. And in many cases, they opt for a doctor who can make the treatment happen without painful augmentations with immediate protocols. Let's get into the mandible. Patient presenting in the practice like this has been implanted before, implants never restored for 7 or 8 years, failing implant deep pocket, and failing endodontically treated teeth before and after the implant to the mesial and the buccal. I remove those roots, place the implants, and that's the 10 years recall immediate implants, infected or at least contaminated teeth in the mandible. This is a daily standard procedure, so don't be afraid of that. Respect the laws of immediacy, and then this is what you get after 10 years and longer. Or this concept. I think that these cases we see every day. Of course, you can retreat them. You can send it to the endodontist, and some endodontists, I'm always surprised what they can achieve, but that's not what we regularly see as a standard of care. Here, I was thinking, and I could do a poll now, but due to the time, I'm not doing it. Where would you place an implant? I placed one implant, not immediate, in the former socket of the heel side of the posterior molar, and the first, the mesial implant, was placed to the mesial socket of the molar. Like this. This is an oval replaced conical. It's placed, it's sutured, it's healed, and then it's restored with a three-digit bridge. This is a standard concept which we perform on a daily basis. Remove the root, clean it, clean the socket, place the implant, scan or take an impression, and then that's the final process. And just look what the arrow indicates where, due to the quality of this implant, due to the properties of the implant, the bone stays. And where it remains over time, over a long time to go. This is also a case which was done many years ago. The treatment rationale is not as complex as you would believe. Immediate implants in infected sockets are evidence-based. They came to stay. They are not going to go away. 3D diagnostics, like all my friends and colleagues said before, reduce diameter implant, palatal and lingual positioning, then use a high-quality implant which works good in your hands. But just by you showing up here today and spending a beautiful day like this today till the evening, you are the heroes of the day, that means that you are using quality products. Clean the socket and then make the bone bleed. You want to open the trabecular. You want to inflict a little micro-bleeding because osseointegration of an implant is fracture healing. Don't just take a wide implant, which is too wide, and press it into the socket. You might see it again after 2 to 3 weeks. It's going to say, hi, here I am, I'm loose. You want to go reduce diameter, and you want to induce some socket wound here. Primary stability, in my eyes, is a key factor. Reevaluate gap filling, but we talked about gap filling. Jose showed the most important papers for that, and he couldn't have done it any better. It was amazing for me to see the summarizing. And the provisionalization, I mean, this was the complete thing today, and I'm happy to wait for your freshly accepted paper to get it into my hands. I want to finish with this quote. For those in the USA who know Babe Ruth, Babe Ruth is, contrary to the name, is not a babe. Babe Ruth was a man. He was an impressive man. He was the best Hall of Famer in the American sport history for baseball. And he said, yesterday's home runs do not win today's games. I think here, I would say, like for Real Madrid, yesterday's goals are not going to win today's games. And we all know how tough this year's season is and how well this applies. What do I mean with this? I mean with this, if you do not do immediate implants or do not offer it in your team, in the complex teamwork, in your dental network you work in, be assured, rest assured, your competition surely will do. They take your patients and they're going to give them a treatment according to the standard of care. And you cannot perform high-end treatment, you cannot go to the Olympics and use last year's sport gear. You got to go modern and you're going to highlight that you are at the top of the standard of care. Thank you for having
me. Perfect, thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Let's take a look at the poll. I want to look at the poll question here. How many of you really do, when you place immediate implant in the posterior region, you put a provisional in there? How many of you do that? Provisionalization on single posterior situations. How many say yes?
Premolar
region? How about molar region?
No, there's no need.
Not, okay, all right. So the thing is this, I want to ask you guys a question. When we do immediate provisionalization, I guess the insertion torque to a certain degree is important. How do you quantify what level of insertion torque or what is the minimal amount of insertion torque that you feel comfortable to load or provisionalize an anterior implant? Let's have Jose and then we go down the line.
Typically speaking, I'm happy with a figure around 30 newton centimeter. 25, 30 newton centimeter seems to be a good figure for immediate provisionalization.
So that means minimal. I'm asking for minimal 30. Anything less than 30, no go.
I would probably say no, yes.
So let's say if you don't do that, what do? You just put the implant in, put a healing abutment in, and call it a day?
I would always have a backup plan on how to provisionalize, sometimes an adhesively bonded bridge, sometimes a removable if it needs
but
to be.
But by doing so, will the gingival architecture collapse in?
Say it again, sir.
Will the gingival architecture collapse in without provisional in
it's
there?
It's not the most ideal situation when that happens, but with a Maryland adhesively bonded bridge, oftentimes we are able to maintain those spaces.
All right.
And again,
perfect.
You know, push in the right
okay.
direction.
How about you? What is the minimal insertion?
Very happy that you ask, because insertion torque says nothing about initial stability, really nothing. We have 35 newton centimeters minimal on double active because I have to mount my temporary abutment. Has nothing to do with the implant. And now with N1, that's why N1 is nice. We have lower torques so I can do my provisionalization, wow, for a Dutch, at lower torques. Really, it's very dangerous to see insertion torque as a connection to initial stability.
So what guidelines do you use?
Sorry?
What guidelines do you use?
I'll explain. The thing is bone to implant contact. All the noble actives we place with a surgical driver. The moment I can keep it loose, it's for one or two threads into the bone. And I measure and I want to have at least 5 millimeters extra to go in because I want to have 6 millimeters really bone to implant contact. That's the best measure for initial stability.
But the thing is you're very experienced. And you're doing flapless. Just imagine,
but
some audience in their second year of school, flapless surgery, you're feeling that? So it's very subjective.
Yeah, but
it?
I want to make one strong point. Industry learned us that insertion torque was connected to initial stability. I give you one example for the ones who are not experienced. If I have a big socket and I under-prepare on the bottom my implant, then I can have very high torque on just one or two threads. And believe me, this implant is not initial stable, and it is high torque. So we have to reconsider torque in relation to initial stability. Those are two separate things.
Okay, Edith, do you have the similar type of concepts or a little bit different?
Well, I totally agree with Tristan, but what also is very important is that the temporary crown is fully held out of occlusion and articulation, of course.
Okay, Oscar?
Yeah, basically, we all agree with that. I'm a little bit even more conservative than Jose. I'm getting older, and normally I was quite aggressive in the past. I was doing a lot of provisional restoration on my immediate implants, but I think I'm getting more conservative as the time goes, because I have also some failures on that. I did my media provisionalization, and a few weeks after, the guy came in with the tooth is moving, and after
so
that, the implant is
doing less and less of provisionalization, so, even anterior ones.
Yeah, in anterior, I'm doing a lot of provisionalization, but I want to make sure that the stability is even higher.
What is your minimal stability that you feel comfortable with?
40.
What is it?
At least 40. But
40?
Yeah.
All right. All
yeah, right. I'm getting old,
okay.
As I say.
And you?
I'm getting old, too. But for me, I once measured my finger force against the torque control because I wanted to know. And if I cannot turn the implant with the instrument anymore, then that's strong enough for me to do an immediate loading. Yeah. But of course, the patient is a factor, occlusion is a factor, and we also have to integrate that into the considerations. Mm-hmm. And don't forget, placing the immediate implant is 5 to 7 minutes. But then, all the hassle with the immediate loading, that's what takes time. That's a time factor. So those patients who are not pushing, who don't want it in any case, we don't push them.
So I think it's very important for you to understand, you know, what type of insertion torque should you use? I mean, because there's no actual black and white guideline. You can hear different people have different concepts there. But then if you use, after you place the implant in, and if you put an implant mount onto the implant, and if you can use your finger to turn it around, twist it around, guess what? How much insertion torque do you think your finger can provide? Okay? Probably based on the literature, between 10, maybe a little bit less than 15. So if that means if the implant is spinning around with your hand, you probably need to rethink, should I go on with the provisionalization? Yes, now, I have another question for you guys. Let's start with, you know, Edith here. I mean, you guys all talk about the show beautiful cases here. Every single one of the surgeries seems to be manual placement. Where do you stand on using, do you guys use guided surgeries at all? And where do you stand on, what's your opinion on guided surgery with immediate implant placement? Each one, I only give you 10 seconds, starting with you, 10 seconds. 6 seconds.
3 more.
I forgot a question, I'm sorry.
Okay, no. So why don't we do this here? So when you do, what do you think are the importance of doing guided surgery with immediate implant placement?
Oh, yes.
Is it good or bad?
Yes. Because we don't perform guided surgery in single implant placements because we place the implant like a banana.
So it's better you use manual. You can feel it better.
Yes, we use manual.
Tristan.
Totally agree. Guided surgery for multiple cases, singles, you are, with Noble Active, you're completely in control in direction.
You can feel it better.
I can
feel
it, so I can
do a surgical time every time routinely just to know where I am. I don't use it as a guide per se, but I have my area of where I am, where I'm working 100% of the time.
Okay, Oscar?
Yeah, the most of the time what I can have is some type of prosthetic guide, but that's not a surgical guide.
Yeah.
Great point.
In my hands.
Gabo?
It's very similar for me.
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, we have very little time, but we give you an idea, at least in 2019, what is the current thinking process of immediate tooth replacement. As you know, I mean, everybody has different concepts. There's no black and white. But still, if you respect the biology, follow the rules, such as proper insertion torque, leave a certain gap, place bone graft material in there, proper prosthetic emergence profile, and controlled occlusion, you should be able to get very good results. So once again, I want to thank my panel. Thank everybody.